All right, well, thank you everyone for coming. Long time no see. This class has been on hold for the last couple of months due to some other wonderful teachers giving teachings, and then also some winter weather. So we're finally here again. It's nice to see you. So for those of you who this may be your first time visiting, this room is always open. We're open 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and you are always welcome in this room to pray or meditate in whatever tradition you would like. It's always been a part of KPC's mission to always have our doors open 24 hours a day and to always be a place of refuge, no matter who needs it or what time of day it is. So before we begin, let's just take a moment to generate compassion and set our intention. We are here to learn about the Dharma, to study the Dharma, so that we can benefit ourselves and others. So in our last class in November, we started talking about the four thoughts that turn the mind, and we're going to continue that discussion today. The four thoughts that turn the mind are called the common foundation. They are common to all Buddhist traditions, and contemplating them is a classic method to prepare yourself to practice Dharma. So contemplation of the four thoughts upholds our spiritual practice, just like a strong foundation will uphold a building. If we don't have a strong foundation for our practice, then it will be very shaky and it could fall down. Just like how if you have a rotten foundation for a building, the building's not going to be around for very long. So to build that solid foundation, we contemplate the four thoughts that turn the mind. Does anyone remember what the four thoughts that turn the mind are? You guys didn't know this, but all of you that were here for my last class, you're going to be teaching the first half of this class. I hope you know that and studied. So who remembers what the four thoughts that turn the mind are? Yeah. Yes, precious human rebirth.
Impermanence.
And then
karma, cause, and effect.
Karma, cause, and effect,
and
yep.
The suffering of samsara.
Yes, the suffering of samsara. All right, so we're going to start by reviewing what we learned last time, which you are all going to help with, and then we'll start going into some new material. So we contemplate the preciousness of our human birth to develop our appreciation for having both the ability and the opportunity to practice the Dharma in this lifetime. Chagdud Tulku Rinpoche says, "We cannot assume that having been human once will be guaranteed a human existence again and again. A human body is very difficult to obtain. It requires the accumulation of a vast amount of merit through scrupulously pure discipline in past lifetimes. Discipline of this kind involves three things: not performing negative acts or harmful behavior, cultivating virtuous thoughts and actions, and having as one's motivation for the first two, and having as one's motivation for observing the first two disciplines an altruistic desire to benefit others. It is only because we have amassed this vast amount of merit, coupled with the aspiration to be reborn as a human being, that we are here now in the human realm." So not only have we obtained a human birth, but we have obtained a precious human rebirth. That's different. Not every human birth is precious. A human existence in which you're born, you live, you maybe work a 9-to-5, have some kids, play some golf, you die, and then your consciousness just moves on to the next experience. That's not a precious human birth. That's an ordinary human birth. Does anyone know what makes a human birth precious? The Dharma, yeah. Specifically, the freedom and leisure to practice the Dharma. The Dzongsar Khyentse Rinpoche wrote, "Buddha explained that human life becomes precious when a human being is free and rich. So what is it that prevents us from being free. Distraction. If we had no distractions, we would be free. And if we were mindful, we would be rich. So don't imagine that a human body qualifies as being precious just because it is healthy, educated, and well-connected. It only becomes precious once that person has met the Dharma and embarked on spiritual practice. So freedom means the opportunity to practice the Dharma, to not be distracted, as Dzongsar Khyentse Rinpoche puts it. There are 8 states that one can be born into in which you do not have the practice, or you don't have the opportunity to practice the Dharma. So we went over this last class. So we're going to see how many of these we can remember. Can anyone name the first state without freedom? We're going to go in order. What is the state that would be the hardest to practice in? The hell realms, yes. So beings in the hell realm do not have the opportunity to practice because they are constantly suffering. All the time they are suffering. They've accumulated many past negative actions, and because of that, they are tormented by intense heat or intense cold, and they suffer tremendous pain. Because of this intense suffering, they can't think of anything else. It fills their whole awareness, and they can't think of anything else, including any possible way that they could escape that suffering. They can't possibly contemplate the Dharma or practice it. What is the second state without freedom? Hungry ghosts. Great, that one was easier. So hungry ghosts don't have the opportunity to practice the Dharma because they are tormented by hunger and thirst. So due to their past negative actions, they've wound up in a situation where all they can think about is how hungry and thirsty they are. Because of that, they have no opportunity to practice the Dharma. They spend every moment searching for something to eat or drink, and that's it. That's their entire existence. What is the third state without freedom? Yeah, animal. So animals don't have the opportunity to practice the Dharma because they are suffering from the attacks of other animals. They're enslaved by humans to, pull heavy carts or do various other tasks. They're just consumed with the task of surviving day to day. And they don't have the wisdom to discern what's right and what's wrong. So even if an animal had a leisurely life, like many of our pets, they don't actually have the ability to discern right from wrong, so they wouldn't be able to engage in the Dharma. What is the fourth state without freedom? Titans? Yeah, the god realms. Don't worry, that's coming up. So the god realms, they don't have any incentive to practice. The beings there are so intoxicated by sensual pleasures that they just can't think of anything else other than how blissful their lives are. They're just intoxicated by it. So, if you could have anything you wished right now at the snap of your fingers, you wouldn't think of, gee, there's a lot of suffering in the world, and maybe I should do something about that. You would just be so consumed with your desire and the satisfaction of that desire. And that's the state that the gods live in. And then there's also some of the gods, there's a few different realms within the god realm, and in some of those, the gods reside in a state of mental blankness, where they've practiced a type of meditation that completely shuts them off from the world. And in that state, they're completely numbed, and they're not able to discern what's right and wrong. So the beings in the 3 lower realms have no opportunity to hear or understand the Dharma because they're suffering so terribly. And the beings in the god realms don't have any incentive to practice because they're suffering so little. Human beings are right in the middle. We're in the little Goldilocks zone, or we have exactly the right amount of suffering. We have enough suffering to want to change, but not so much suffering that we can't do anything about it. However, there are still 4 types of human existence where you wouldn't have the opportunity to practice. Webb, I think you know the next one. Do you want to say it?
Time and place
Yeah, being born as a barbarian is the next one, which would be being born in a place where the doctrine of the Buddha is unknown. So if no one knows the Dharma, then how are you going to learn it, right? It's pretty common sense. But there's also, barbarian can also refer to those born in a culture that is dominated by wrong view, which would be a culture where people consider harming others an act of faith, or they believe that taking life is a good thing to do. It's a positive thing. So in those kinds of cultures, that also would be a barbarian way of life. So if you're born in a place where there's no Dharma, there's no Sangha, no community of practitioners, there's no one to teach you the Dharma, then, and there's no one to even teach you about developing loving kindness or wisdom, you're learning to harm others, then there would be no opportunity to practice the Dharma. So does anyone want to take a guess at the sixth state? I heard a couple potentials. Nope, close. That's on the list. It's on the list. All of these things are on the list. So the sixth state without freedom is having wrong views. So when we have wrong views are beliefs that are contrary to the teachings of the Buddha. So if you are believing things such as, if you believe that actions have no cause, and you know, if actions don't have any effect, or if you believe in eternalism or nihilism, those things are contrary to the teachings of the Buddha. So then, even if you were to try to listen to the Dharma, you would be thinking something that is contrary to the Dharma and believing something contrary to it. So you would not be able to practice the Dharma. Patrul Rinpoche says, these kinds of beliefs spoil our minds and prevent us from aspiring to the authentic Dharma to the extent that we no longer have the opportunity to practice it. So, to the extent that we no longer have the opportunity to practice it, that means, you know, since we do believe in karma and cause and effect, if we are creating the causes through wrong view to no longer have the opportunity to practice it, then we may wind up as a result of that in one of these other realms, or we do not have the opportunity to practice the Dharma. So what is the seventh state without freedom? That is actually, I think, more what you were saying. The seventh state without freedom is being born when there is no Buddha. If you were born in a time between Buddhas, so that would be the time when all memory of the previous Buddha, all memory of his teachings, all written records of those teachings, that has all disappeared from memory, and the next Buddha has not yet appeared. So living in that gap, no one will have heard of the Buddha, Dharma, or Sangha. And so you would have no way to learn how to distinguish good from bad, and if there's no teachings of the Dharma, you can't practice the Dharma. So an example of this is that when Prince Siddhartha was born, the great hermit sage Asita came to visit him. He came to visit the king and meet the baby. And he prophesied that this baby, Prince Siddhartha, would grow up to either become a great king or a great spiritual leader. And then Asita began to weep. And the king was very concerned. And he said, oh no, what do you see? What's wrong with my son? And Asita said, no. If I weep, it is for myself. I apologize, it's a very long passage, but I thought it's very beautiful, so I'm going to read it in full. Asita said, if I weep, it is for myself. My life draws to a close, and he is born, he who will destroy the evil of rebirth. He will surrender sovereign power. He will master his passions. He will understand truth, and error will disappear in the world before the light of his knowledge, even as night flees before the spears of the sun. From the sea of evil, from the stinging spray of sickness, from the surge and swell of old age, from the angry waves of death, from these will he rescue the suffering world, and together they will sail away in the great ship of knowledge. He will know where it takes its rise, that swift, wonderful, beneficent river, the river of duty. He will reveal its course, and those who are tortured by thirst will come and drink of its waters. To those tormented by sorrow, to those enslaved by the senses, to those wandering in the forest of existences like travelers who have lost their way. He will point out the road to salvation. To those burning with the fire of passion, he will be the cloud that brings refreshing rain. Armed with the true law, he will go to the prison of desires where all creatures languish, and he will break down the evil gates. For he who will have perfect understanding will set the world free. Therefore, do not grieve, O King. He alone is to be pitied who will not hear the voice of your son. And that is why I weep. I, who in spite of my austerities, in spite of my meditations, will never know his message and his law. Yes, even he is to be pitied who ascends to the loftiest gardens of the sky. So Asita recognized that since he was born at this time where he was going to die, before the Buddha would begin teaching, he recognized that he had been born in a time between Buddhas. And so he would not have that opportunity. He was so close. He was within a decade, maybe, or two decades of, you know, being able to hear the Buddha's teachings. He was so close, but he missed his chance, and he knew he was going to not have that opportunity. And so he wept. So that is an example of being born in the time between Buddhas. The eighth state without freedom, so I don't want to guess, it's come up.
Faculties,
yes. So being born with physical or mental handicaps that make it impossible for you to listen to or understand the teachings, that would make it impossible for you to practice the Dharma. If you cannot comprehend the teachings, you would not be able to put them into practice. So those are the eight states without freedom. In order for a life to be considered a precious human birth, it must have these eight freedoms. But we said freedom and leisure to practice, right? So what is leisure? In lieu of leisure, we have the 10 advantages. And these are broken into two different lists. There are 5 circumstantial advantages and 5 individual advantages. So let's see if we can remember the 5 circumstantial advantages. First one. What gets the Dharma into the world?
The Buddha.
The Buddha appeared. So we have the advantage of the presence of the teacher. Not only did the Buddha appear, but what else happened? He taught. He taught the Dharma. So we have the advantage of the teaching of the Dharma. Not only did the Buddha teach the Dharma, but they remain. Yeah, the teachings still exist. And so we have the advantage of the time. Not only do the teachings exist, that's right, we have a community of practice. There are practitioners who have realized these teachings, and they provide a living transmission of the teachings. And through their example, those teachings become accessible to us. And so we have the advantage of our own good fortune. Not only do we have that good fortune, what else do we have?
People with loving care in our hearts.
Yes, people with loving kindness. So we have teachers is really what that means. We can learn and practice and accomplish the teachings only because we have a Lama who, out of their boundless compassion, has decided to teach us instead of remaining in solitude and practice. So it's only through the Lama's extraordinary compassion that we are able to learn these teachings well and actually put them into practice. So we possess the advantage of the Lama's extraordinary compassion. So those are the 5 circumstantial advantages. And then there are 5 individual advantages, which are ones that come from our own individual nature. Does anyone know the first one? It's the topic of today's class. Yes, precious human birth. You've been born a human. So without a human life, it would not be possible to encounter the Dharma. There are the rare stories of animals encountering the Dharma or beings in other realms, the god realms. There was the Buddha appeared to his mother in the god realms. And, you know, there are these rare other circumstances. Generally speaking, you will not be able to access and engage with the Dharma, except for in this human form. So if you have a human body, you have the advantage of support. The next one, anyone know? Yes, born in a land where the Dharma is practiced, also called being born in a central place. So if you've been born in a country where the Dharma exists, you have the advantage of place. The third one is to be born with all one's faculties. Some of these repeat. So if you don't have any disabilities which prevent you from seeing images of the Buddha or reading and hearing the texts, then you have the advantage of possessing the sense faculties. The fourth, anyone know? Is that another way of saying conflicting lifestyle?
Yes.
Okay. I thought so, but I didn't see it that way in the books that I read for this particular class. So, having a conflicting lifestyle would prevent you from practicing the Dharma. So a conflicting lifestyle would be those of hunters or prostitutes, gangs. If you're involved in very negative activities from a young age, or if you pick up a negative lifestyle, like joining a gang, you would not be able to practice the Dharma well. But if you have the wish to do positive actions, then you have the advantage of intention. And the fifth, this is the greatest of the individual advantages. Does anyone know what it is? Faith. Yes, faith. So having faith in the Dharma. Faith is the only way for the blessings of the Buddhas to enter our mind streams. So without faith, we're pretty much sunk. As Dilgo Khyentse Rinpoche said, if you have no faith, even following the Buddha himself will not help you. But if you have the ability to turn your mind to the Dharma, then you have the advantage of faith. So if you look at your own life and circumstances, and you see that all of these conditions are present, then you have what is called human life endowed with the 18 freedoms and advantages. However, there's more. So the omniscient Dharma King Longchenpa, in his wish-granting treasury, he said that there are 16 additional conditions that preclude any opportunity to practice the Dharma. So Patrul Rinpoche says that many people will look as if they have all the freedoms and advantages and are true practitioners of the Dharma. They truly have a precious human rebirth. But if you look a little closer, they may not, until you check for these 16 additional factors. You might not be practicing the true Dharma. So these are broken down into two lists, many, many lists. So the 16 factors, the first list is the 8 intrusive circumstances that leave no freedom. So the 8 intrusive circumstances that leave no freedom make it impossible to continue practicing the Dharma. The first is turmoil from the 5 emotions. If your negative emotions, such as hatred for enemies or infatuation with friends and family, if that is extremely strong, it will prevent you from accomplishing the Dharma properly. The second is stupidity. If you're very stupid and not intelligent enough to understand the Dharma, to understand even a simple teaching or like a single word or phrase of the Dharma, then you wouldn't have any ability to study the Dharma or reflect upon it or put it into practice. The third is being dominated by evil influences. If you've become a disciple of a false spiritual friend, someone who teaches the view and action in a perverted manner, then your mind will be led down wrong paths and you would not be able to practice the Dharma purely. So this is a very dangerous one because even a very slight perversion can really send you off onto a wrong course. Even if you think of, for instance, trying to shoot an arrow, when you draw back your bow, if you're just like a little bit off right here, that arrow could be a mile off the target. You don't have to be very far off the target here and where your hand is. An inch of a difference will make a very big difference once that arrow starts flying. And so it's very important to have discernment about the teachers and books from which you learn. The fourth is laziness. If you lack diligence and you want to study the Dharma, but you're too lazy to practice, you're not really going to practice. Patrul Rinpoche says, you will be too ensnared by your own indolence and procrastination to ever accomplish it. The fifth is being inundated by the effect of past evil actions. So we know that we've all created some good karma, some bad karma in the past, but Patrul Rinpoche says, some people's obscurations and negative actions are such that in spite of the effort they put into the Dharma, they fail to develop any of the right qualities in their minds. Their backlog of bad actions has overwhelmed them, and they will lose confidence in the teachings without perceiving that it is due to their own past actions. The sixth is enslavement to others. If you're in servitude to someone else and you don't have the autonomy to practice the Dharma, even if you wish to practice the Dharma, you know, maybe this person who you are enslaved by, they don't allow you to, so you wouldn't be able to practice the Dharma. So in our country, we have a very particular idea of slavery, but there's a number of different types of slavery that people fall victim to, from, you know, sex trafficking, to child labor, to a forced marriage, and a variety of other circumstances that are actually a lot more common than people think, especially in this country, like, you know, indentured servitude, you know, like forced labor in the home is a really big one. There's been some cases in Potomac, even just locally, within the last few years, of people who have been kidnapped from their home countries and held as slaves here. You know, this happens. But there's also more subtle forms of slavery that might happen. You know, one example of this could be if you are in an abusive relationship and your partner will not allow you to practice, then you would not have the opportunity to practice the Dharma because you're in a situation where you don't have the autonomy to follow your desire to practice. So there are many different types of situations that we could find ourselves in which we would not be able to practice the Dharma for that reason, due to someone's control over our lives. The seventh is seeking protection from dangers. Some people take up the Dharma out of fear for this present life, out of some worldly concern. Maybe they're afraid that they'll go hungry, or they won't be able to support themselves, so they, you know, maybe they decide to take up robes for that reason. Maybe they decide to become a monk or nun because it's their free retirement plan. They're just going to, you know, sign up and wear the robes and be fed. So that's not practicing the Dharma. I don't think you have much luck with that in this country anyways. It probably would happen more in India and Tibet, but but basically, if you lack conviction in the Dharma, if you're practicing for the wrong reasons, you're trying to do it because of some worldly desire like that, then you're not developing proper motivation and you'll return to your old habits. So you'll get involved in things that aren't Dharma because you don't really have conviction in the Dharma. So the eighth is hypocritical practice. Patrul Rinpoche says that some people are imposters who, through a pretense of Dharma, try to win possessions, services, and prestige. In front of others, they assume the guise of practitioners, but in their minds, they are only interested in this life, and so they are far removed from the path to liberation. So again, if your concern is just about this life, then you're not truly practicing the Dharma. So those are the eight intrusive circumstances that leave no freedom and that make it impossible to continue practicing the Dharma. The next list is the eight incompatible propensities that leave no freedom. These are very long titles. The eight incompatible propensities that leave no freedom. So these propensities lead one away from the Dharma and snuff out the lamp to liberation. The first is being bound by one's ties. So if you're tightly bound to your worldly commitments, wealth, pleasure, children, relatives, friends, and so forth, if you're so preoccupied with the strenuous efforts entailed by these things, you'll have no time to practice the Dharma. I'm sure many people having careers and that kind of thing find this to be true, where you may find yourself to not be able to practice the Dharma because there's so much in your life. I mean, there's so much all the time asking for our attention, right? There's work, there's social engagements, there's friends and family, there's just so many things that want our attention. If we are so consumed by them that we can't find time to practice, then you can't find time to practice. Dilgo Khyentse Rinpoche says, using your human life to achieve trivial aims is like storing garbage in a golden vase. The second is flagrant depravity. So if you just totally lack kindness, you don't have any humanity about you at all, you're just totally unkind and cruel, and you're unable to improve your behavior, even just the slightest little bit, then even a genuine spiritual teacher would find it really difficult to work with you. They would find it really hard to set you on the right path. It's said that the abilities of a disciple can be shaped, but not their basic character. And Buddhism does have a really strong theme of personal responsibility also. So there's an idea, I think a lot of times people have an idea that, oh, well, if I find my guru, if I follow this lama, they'll just fix me. But that's not how it works. It's definitely a need for personal responsibility and internal motivation here. No guru is just going to snap their fingers and solve your problems. So the third is lack of dissatisfaction with samsara. If you hear of lower rebirths and the fault of samsara, and you don't feel even the slightest bit of consternation, and I want to look this up. Does anyone know what the definition of consternation is? I know there's an English teacher sitting in the back row. There's that. Another definition of it also, which I found, which I think is a little bit more specific to this one, is fear resulting from the awareness of danger. So if you are hearing of the dangers of this world, if you're hearing of the dangers of the lower rebirths, of the hell realms, if you're hearing about, you know, the way that your actions can cause effects that you may not like going to the hell realms, if you're not feeling any fear at that danger, then you're not fully appreciating the precariousness of your situation. If you don't appreciate the danger of your precarious situation, then you won't have enough determination to practice the Dharma properly. If you don't have any determination to liberate yourself from samsara, then why would you even engage in practice, right? You have to really understand that this is a dangerous situation that you need to get out of. If you understood yourself to be on the sinking Titanic, you would be scrambling to figure out what to do to get off that boat. But if you don't realize that the Titanic is sinking, you're just going to listen to the music, right? You're not going to do anything. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, these overlap and interplay a lot. Yeah. And if you're not recognizing the dangerousness of your emotions and of following your emotions, you know, again, it's like then you won't have any reason to disengage from them. And so, yeah, you would wind up being continually caught up in the turmoil of your emotions without trying to do anything to stop it because you don't realize how dangerous it is to be caught up in them. So the fourth is complete absence of faith. If you have no faith in the Dharma at all, either in the true Dharma or in your teacher, then even if you listen to the teachings, you will not be able to truly access them and understand them and put them into practice. The fifth is taking pleasure in bad actions. And this also goes back to, you know, living in a culture which reveres bad actions. You know, these overlap as well. So if you take pleasure in harmful or negative actions and fail to control your thoughts, words, and deeds, then you will have turned away from the Dharma, and you will have turned away from the noble qualities of your own true nature. Anytime you're engaging in negativity, you are turning away from your true nature. The sixth is having lack of interest in the Dharma. So if it just doesn't interest you, if you have no enthusiasm for it, its qualities are never going to develop in your mind. You have to develop some kind of interest. The seventh is heedlessness of the vows. So if you've entered the basic vehicles and you break your vows, you break your commitment to bodhicitta, then you would fall to the lower realms where there's no opportunity to practice the Dharma. And similarly, number eight is heedlessness of the samayas. And if you've entered the secret mantra vehicle and you break your samaya commitments to your teacher and to your sangha, to your spiritual community, that also would destroy any chance of accomplishing your practice. The commitments that we take on this path are there to strengthen our connection to the path. And so when we break them, we weaken our connection to the path. So those are the eight incompatible propensities that leave no freedom. So before all of these have been ruled out, it may look like someone has a precious human rebirth and that they have all the freedoms and advantages necessary to engage properly in the Dharma. But looking like a Dharma practitioner is not the same as practicing Dharma. Patrul Rinpoche says that no matter what a person may look like, whether they are a spiritual teacher or a hermit living in a mountain solitude somewhere, anyone who might have a high opinion of their own worth, anyone at all, each person might think they are practicing the Dharma, but as long as they are under the sway of these additional limiting conditions, they are not truly practicing the Dharma. So it's important to examine carefully whether or not you have all of the elements of these freedoms and advantages. And it's not something we can do just once or twice. This is something we have to continually check. Our minds, our state of mind is constantly changing, right? We could have a flash of faith followed by a wave of doubt. We might not usually be very angry, but then someone really pushes our buttons and we get really angry at them. You need to be aware of that. You have to be aware of the state of your own mind and aware that it is limiting you in that moment from practicing the Dharma. If you fail to check your mind and one of these elements is lacking, then you're losing the opportunity to practice the Dharma right. You have the opportunity to see, am I doing this right? And if you don't take the time to check, then you may wind up practicing something that's not quite right, not quite the true Dharma. Now that we know how rare and precious this opportunity of our human life is, then we know it would be stupid of us to waste that opportunity by practicing, you know, under the sway of our emotions or practicing without faith or practicing in any of these other conditions that would not be truly practicing right. That would be a waste of our human life and of this opportunity. We want to make sure to do this right because we just have this one chance. So we want to do the best job we possibly can. So if you check your mind and you see that you do have all of the elements of these freedoms and advantages, then you should rejoice in it. And you should reflect on them over and over again and rejoice in how fortunate you are. You should think to yourself, now that I finally gained these freedoms and advantages that are so difficult to find, I will not squander them. No matter what happens, I will practice the authentic Dharma. And if you check your mind and you find that some aspects are missing, then just try to do whatever you can to get them. Don't rest on your laurels and think that it's okay to just keep all that anger and greed and ignorance in your mind. You know, don't just be like, oh, I'm angry. Okay. You have to work with it, to recognize it, and then work with it. So why is it so important to have all of the freedoms and advantages? Why isn't it enough to have like 75% or 90%, like 90%, like it's like 91% is an A, I think, right? Like 91 and up. So like, why isn't that good enough? If you think about it, even the execution of a single minor task requires, like such as making tea. Making tea requires many mutually dependent materials and conditions to come together, right? Is it any wonder then, Patrul Rinpoche asks, that the realization of our ultimate goal, the Dharma, is impossible without the conjunction of many interconnected factors. So let's think about what it takes to make tea. To make tea, you need many different things, right? You need the kettle, the water, you need sufficient heat to boil the water, the tea itself. If any one of those are missing, you can't make tea. You could go even further with that. You've got the well or the municipal water system that brought you potable water. You have the electricity that is turning on your stove, or perhaps you have a gas stove, or you're using a fire, then you have wood that you've brought to make the fire, all these elements. You have the grocery store where you bought your tea, the trucks that carried it there, the farmers that grew it, the pollinators, the conditions of the soil, the amount of rain it got. So many factors came together for your one cup of tea. And if any of one of those factors was not present, you wouldn't have tea. If it didn't rain that year, no tea. If the bees died, no tea. The farmers went on strike, no tea. You know, all of these things have to actually come together in order for us to make tea. If you have 75% of the materials, you still do not have tea. You can have the water and the tea and the stove, but you don't have a kettle to put the water in, so you're out of luck. You know, if you're missing any one of these things, you can't make tea. Patrul Rinpoche says, in the same way, if even one element of the freedoms and advantages is missing, there is no chance at all to practice the true Dharma. So imagine you're born a human, you have all your faculties intact, you're born in a land where the Dharma exists, but you have a conflicting lifestyle and no faith. You have three of the advantages. If you changed your lifestyle but didn't develop faith, you'd still only have four. Still not enough. It's actually quite difficult to have a lifestyle that doesn't conflict at all with the Dharma. Patrul Rinpoche says, if any of a person's thoughts, words, and deeds are negative, and his motives are for this life, in fact, even if he has the reputation of a good and learned man, his lifestyle is in conflict with the Dharma. So, if any of a person's thoughts, words, and deeds are negative, and his motives are for this life, we can all just reflect on whether that applies to us. That lifestyle would be in conflict with the Dharma. So, and the same applies to the five circumstantial advantages. If anyone is missing, you would not be able to practice the Dharma. If a Buddha has come, has taught the Dharma, the teachings still exist, but you have not entered the Dharma, then you only have three of the advantages. And Patrul Rinpoche says, entering the Dharma does not simply mean asking for a teaching and being given it. The starting point of the path to liberation is the conviction that the whole of samsara is meaningless and the genuine determination to be free of it. To travel the path of the great vehicle, the essential is to have genuinely aroused bodhicitta. And the minimum is to have such unshakable faith in the three precious jewels that you would never renounce them even to save your life. Without that, simply reciting prayers and wearing yellow robes is no proof that you have entered the Dharma. So we can have all of these circumstances. We can have the Buddha can come, the Buddha can teach the Dharma, the teachings can still exist, we can have this wonderful temple here and come and hang out here. But if we're not genuinely determined to be free of samsara, if we are not cultivating unshakable faith in the three jewels, that's not enough, you know? You can't just show up in the temple and think that's enough. There has to be more than that. You have to really develop a deep conviction that samsara is meaningless and be committed to being free from it. So only then is that having that advantage. So it's very important that we know how to identify each of these freedoms and advantages and to check our minds to see if we have them. One of the ways that we can understand just how rare this human life is, how precious this opportunity is through reflecting on numerical comparisons. So, if the inhabitants of the hell realms were as numerous as the stars in the night sky, the hungry ghosts would be as numerous as the number of stars visible in the daytime. How many stars can you see in the daytime? One. That was your science quiz for the day. So likewise, if there were as many hungry ghosts as stars in the night sky, there would only be one animal then, only as many animals as stars in the daytime. And if there were as many animals as stars in the night sky, there would only be as many gods and humans as stars in the daytime. So another way of putting that is that for every human, there are as many animals as there are stars in the sky. For every animal, there are as many hungry ghosts as there are stars. And for every hungry ghost, there are as many hell beings as there are stars. Make you feel very small, right? Imagine how many beings there are. It's also said that there are as many beings in hell as there are specks of dust in the whole world, and as many hungry ghosts as there are particles of sand in the Ganges River, and as many animals as grains in a beer barrel, which is referring to this Tibetan way of making beer, which the barrel's completely full of grains to the brim, and so that's really, there are as many animals as grains in a beer barrel full of grains. and there are as many demigods or asuras as there are snowflakes in a blizzard. But gods and humans, there are only as few as there are particles of dust on your fingernail. So you can think of the particles of dust in your fingernail as all the humans and gods, and then compare that to all of the specks of dust in the entire world and think that is how many beings in the hell realms there are. And just think of how precious it is to be one of these specks of dust. So this demonstrates how incredibly rare it is to be born in a human form. And rarer still than that is a human life with all the freedoms and advantages. So another way that we can understand the preciousness of this human life and how rare it is through reflecting on metaphors, on metaphorical images. So one example is the image of, if you imagine throwing dried peas at a smooth wall, and how difficult it would be to get a single pea to stick to the wall. It's basically impossible, right? They're all going to bounce off. So that is about how difficult it is to be born a human. Another example would be balancing a pile of peas on an upright needle. A lot of peas going on here. But if you can imagine how difficult it would be to balance, you know, to balance some peas on a needle. You don't get to poke the pea with a needle. There's no cheating. You just have to balance it. It'd be very difficult. The Buddha said that it is more difficult for a being to obtain a human birth than it would be for a turtle to rise from the depths of the ocean and by chance put its head through a wooden yoke that was being tossed about on the waves. So let's imagine this. Imagine the whole cosmos of a billion universes as a vast ocean. Floating on that ocean is a wooden yoke, like one you would use to attach oxen to a cart, you know, the wooden board with a hole in it. So this yoke is just tossed every which way by the waves. It doesn't stay in the same place, even for a single instant. And deep down in the depths of the ocean, there lives this old blind turtle. And once every 100 years, this turtle rises to the surface. How unlikely would it be for the turtle and the yoke to meet? The yoke is an inanimate object. It's not trying to go anywhere. It's just inanimate, floating on the surface of this ocean. The turtle is blind, doesn't even know the yoke is there. Even if it knew the yoke was there, it wouldn't have any way to spot it or move towards it. It is purely by chance that if this turtle comes up out of the water and the yoke just happens to be in the exact right spot, not 6 inches to the left, not, you know, a few inches to the right, it has to be in the exact right spot for that turtle to poke its head through. It would be more difficult than that to obtain a precious human birth. So I have something to share just for fun. Does anyone here know the poet Jack Kerouac, famous beat poet? So he wrote a poem about this, the story of the turtle. And I thought we could just listen to it real quick.
You know, in the ocean, there's a very sad turtle. Even though the SS mainline fishing ship is reeling in the Merritt like mad, swims long-mouthed and sad, looking for the impossible, except once afternoon when the yoke, oh, the old Buddha yoke, set afloatin', is in the water where the turtle raises his bewatery snop to the sea, and the yoke yokes the turtle of eternity. Tell me, oh bhikkhus, what are the chances of such a happening? For the turtle is old and the yoke free, and the seven oceans bigger than any we see in this tiny party. Chances are slender. In a million, million, billion cotis of eons and incalculables, yes, the turtle will set that yoke free. But till then, harder yet are the chances for a man to be reborn a man in this karma earth.
It's a fun thing to share. Now you can think of that big watery snop coming up out of the sea. It'll give you an image to contemplate. So now we have a sense of just how rare it is to obtain this human life. And we know that a human life can only be called precious when it's endowed with the 10 freedoms and all of the advantages, or the 8 freedoms and 10 advantages. So from then onward, it truly becomes precious. The freedoms and advantages don't come by chance. They don't come by luck. Even though we talk about the turtle only by chance finding that yoke, it's actually not through chance at all that we do. You can't gain the freedoms and advantages through any kind of resourcefulness or trickery. The only way that you can obtain them is through the power of the merit that you have accumulated. So if we don't use this opportunity to create merit, then what are we doing? We've got this precious human life. Why would we not want to create the conditions for us to have another one? If we don't use this opportunity, then as Patrul Rinpoche says, in lives to come, it will be very hard to obtain such freedom again. Once you take birth in any of the forms of life in the lower realms, no idea of Dharma will ever occur to you. Too bewildered to know what to do or what not to do, you will fall endlessly further and further to ever lower realms. So we must use this opportunity while we have it. Our human body is like a precious jewel, or like $1 million. So why is a jewel precious? Why is money precious? Because you can get anything with it. With a jewel or with enough money, you can get anything you need. You can get anything that anyone else needs, too. So you have a jewel body, a jewel speech, a jewel mind. They're precious. Whatever you want, you can get with these. It means you have to take care of your jewel body. You can't just throw it away. You don't want to take stupid risks like drunk driving or bungee jumping or not take care of your health and just throw your body out the window. This is a precious opportunity that we have here. We want to make sure that we have as much of this opportunity as we can possibly have. We don't want to cut short this life. And we also don't want to waste our chance by engaging in the 5 poisons. This body is like a container that you are stuck in. It's kind of like a jail. But it's a jail that you can do a lot in. If you spend your life just increasing the 5 poisons, then not only will you remain in the jail of samsara, but you'll be putting on your own handcuffs. But you get to choose what you put in your container body. So do you want to fill your container with poop, with hatred and greed and ignorance? Or do you want to fill it with jewels? You're the one that has to live in it for the next 100 years. So if you want it filled with poop, you can do that, but I think it'd be nicer to have it filled with jewels. Gyaltsa Rinpoche says, this body is more than a diamond body with a price of $100 million, so we don't need to waste that. You have this treasure, so don't be stingy. Don't be stingy toward yourself, but use your more than diamonds body to benefit yourself. Don't be stingy toward others, but use it to benefit them too. Recognize your property, what you have. In one way, your property is like public property for others. You have a precious body, and not only that, you have interest in the Dharma. You can study and practice. So pray for sentient beings. And he continues, when you see what you have, then you will be more careful with it. If you saw you had a jewel, you would be so careful with it. I'm not talking about a jewel, though. I am talking about your Buddha nature. This human body is the container for that. Whoa, more than any jewel. A jewel is nothing. Among all the jewels, your Buddha nature is the real jewel. You can't lose this jewel, but becoming obscured, then it seems to be lost. This is your jewel, but it doesn't belong to you. It is all Buddha's jewel. It is all Bodhisattva's jewel. It is the jewel that benefits all sentient beings. It is the jewel of wisdom mind. It belongs to everybody. So perhaps if we think of ourselves as the stewards of this precious jewel, that is everybody's jewel, is here for the benefit of everyone, and we need to make sure that we use it and we don't cover it up with our five poisons, but that we treasure it and we take care of it and we polish it so it shines so that we can get everything that every being needs for them. So as usual, we're going to end this class with a brief meditation to stabilize our minds. So in order to effectively notice and disengage from the habits that we've been talking about, from the eight intrusive circumstances and the eight incompatible propensities, in order to be able to recognize those, to see them for what they are, and to disengage from them, we need to create some kind of stability and spaciousness in our minds. Jetsuma says, no one can get rid of desire, get rid of pride, or get rid of anger if there is not enough stability and spaciousness to look at what is in one's mind, to see how we are acting, and to see what it is going to bring about. There must be a little space to do that. We have to be able to step back from our own minds long enough to watch these reactions, to see where they come from, instead of being automatically swept up by whatever reaction we're having in the moment. So this meditation that we're going to do is from Jetsuma's book, Stabilizing the Mind, my Vanna White here. Highly recommend this book. So this is a simple meditation that you can try anytime. All we're going to do is watch the breath. So sit comfortably with your back straight. And you can place your hands in your lap, just gently relaxed. And allow yourself to breathe normally. I'm going to just set a timer real quickly. So what we're going to do is just put a very light attention on our breathing. Don't try to control it at all. Just breathe naturally. And put the most gossamer thin attention on your breath. It's kind of like taking your pulse. You don't put any pressure on it, you just observe it. Your attention should be like a feather, just gently riding on the surface of your breath. Your ego doesn't want you to meditate, so it's going to do its very best to distract you. And the way to handle this is to disengage. Don't try to suppress your thoughts. Don't tell yourself to stop thinking or try to replace your thoughts with positive, blissful thoughts. Just let your thoughts be exactly as they are. Your meditation is not lost by hearing your thoughts, but by following them down the road. So if you find yourself following a thought, drop it. You don't have to examine it and see whether it's a good thought or a bad thought. Doesn't matter. Drop it like it's hot. Just return to your breath. If it helps, you can use the image. Drop it like it's hot. you like, you can use an image of like tongs, like spaghetti tongs or something, you know, like cooking tongs, if that helps, to just an image of dropping it, letting it go. But basically when thoughts come up, just let them go like they're bubbles popping on the surface of a pond. And just let them pop. Don't even look to see what they are. Just keep the most gossamer-thin attention on your breath. So we'll just meditate for 5 minutes. So, now I have a handout that I'd like for all of us to read together as a closing. If I could get a volunteer to pass these out, please. Anyone? Thank you, Ani. So in this handout, there are some wishing prayers. Wishing prayers are important and they are very powerful. Jetsuma has said that time and again, great bodhisattvas have been reborn in the world in India or Tibet, whose practice was not terribly extensive. They were very simple people. But because they made such heartfelt wishing prayers, they cultivated such a deep desire to be of benefit to others. Through the force of those prayers alone, they were reborn in a way that could benefit many, many beings. So this is a wonderful way that we can, even if we don't feel like we have a lot of spiritual ability, we can always make wishing prayers that we will in the future, and that we will have a human life in the future. So the front page of this is just a little collage that I made, and I thought I would share it with you. I wasn't expecting so many people. Maybe people can share. Yeah. Sorry about that. All right. Does everyone have at least one that they are sharing with someone else? All right. So we're going to read this first prayer. This is by Patrul Rinpoche. Although I have won these freedoms, I am poor in Dharma, which is their essence. Although I have entered the Dharma, I waste time doing other things. Bless me and foolish beings like me, that we may attain the very essence of the freedoms and advantages. And then let's go to the next one, the aspiration prayer. Throughout all lifetimes, wherever I am born, may I obtain the seven qualities of birth in a higher realm. May I meet the Dharma immediately after taking birth and have the freedom to practice accordingly. May I please the venerable spiritual masters and practice Dharma day and night. By understanding the Dharma and accomplishing its inmost essence, may I traverse the ocean of worldly existence in that very life. Within the world, may I expound the highest sacred doctrine and never become bored or weary of accomplishing the welfare of others. And by my own tremendous impartial service to others, may all beings attain Buddhahood together. And then I'll read this dedication, which I must admit I made a typo in. In the last line, it says through, where it should say throughout. By this effort, may all sentient beings be free of suffering. May their minds be filled with the nectar of virtue. In this way, may all causes resulting in suffering be extinguished, and only the light of compassion shine throughout all realms. All right, thank you for coming, everyone. Thanks.